Hello, everybody. Welcome to the Trifles and Tribulations podcast, where we pronounce words incorrectly and talk about other things that are annoying.
Where nothing works and everything breaks.
Indeed.
I have no idea what the fuck happened.
The only the only technical issues that I ever really struggle with are the ones that I can't diagnose and find a problem. I mean, that's my big thing, and my one big thing is when stuff doesn't work when it should, and don't know how to fix it.
Yeah. I fucking hate that. I'm with you.
Why did you at me when you...
I don't know. Look, it was spur of the moment, okay?
You're just posting it. I was going to be my goodness, if he said that he wasn't going to at everyone and then at everyone, I was gonna tear you a new one.
No, see, I only just added you, the person already in the call.
Good.
Oh my god.
Look,
you know what?
You did the one and only thing that I hate about Discord.
You know what? I've been slowly embracing the himbo term the last couple of days now, and this is just me falling into it.
Sure.
One brain cell, and it's devoted to not thinking.
It's amazing how the term himbo can actually be claimed and is sort of endearing, but the female bimbo is absolutely still an insult.
Oh, no, it's very much an insult for me to call myself a himbo, but I just don't care. I'm a man slut. I mean, I admit it.
I mean, that's still an insult.
There's no point in denying it anymore. but yes. Well,
simp is still an insult, I believe.
Telgar decides that he's finally a man slut. And Sparrow complains about me adding him.
Yes. This is the podcast where we talk about things that annoy us and just sort of grind our gears and build up to the point where we just can't handle it anymore, so we're gonna get it out there.
Live, on air.
Yes, exactly. With no filter, because that's what we need.
None. Except for the filters that Twitch Daddy forces on us.
Usually how we go about this is I ask, hey guys, how have we been this week? And then we'll do some small talk, maybe go over the things that have troubled us this week. And then we always go to me because I always have a list of things that I want about, because I'm the one that made this podcast, because there are things that I just need to say because they just need to be said. Also, I didn't change the category from Legends of Runeterra to podcast, so I'm going to do that now. Speaking of things that are annoying.
I forget that so often. Yeah. Oh, man. But yeah, usually I always have something to go off of as well, but lately the last...
these podcasts are streamed live on Twitch, and if you want to be a part of them, come join me on Twitch. And these aren't just YouTube uploads.
That's true.
That is legitimately something that bothered me. Sorry, just to finish this tangent real quick. I hate when people just upload straight VODs to YouTube, and so that's why I try to make this very streamlined and professional and not mention Twitch or chat or anything, and just make it like a recording that is live on Twitch.
Yep.
Because I could just do this live on YouTube, but nobody cares about live YouTube. And the reason why I know that is because I've done both.
I mean,
at least when I'm...
I don't think it's necessarily that people don't care about live on YouTube. I think live on YouTube has a completely different audience.
Fair.
Like, on Twitch, you've got an audience that'll be up for almost anything. On YouTube, I feel like people are specifically looking for certain content. It's either long form content that they don't have to interact with, or it's idols.
I'll be honest.
Idols specifically.
When I stream into the void for zero views, I want it to be on Twitch and not YouTube, because I want to hate Twitch and not YouTube. I actually do get more views when I stream on Twitch, though.
Yeah. I've been needing to start multicasting, and honestly, I'm just haven't set it up yet. That's literally the only reason why I haven't done it yet.
I'll be honest, when you do streams on Twitch and then make those into montages on YouTube, they don't do as good.
Mm-hmm. Oh, no. They're
if
not
you want
really
to make a YouTube
to...
video, you have to make a YouTube video.
Yeah, exactly. You don't make videos on YouTube as montages or as VODs. You can, but they're not going to do very good, because that's not what the algorithm is looking for. YouTube algorithm is usually looking for people that are looking for A, small clips, or B, really long form stuff that they can watch for hours on end.
Well, that's sort of what montages is. They're a combination of small little clips, and they do go on for a long time. So people can just like put them on, and then they have like a long stream of memes that they get to watch. The point I was trying to make is that if you are going to montage something, you have to go into the recording session with that part in mind, which is something that you don't do when you're live streaming. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
That's all I was trying to say.
True. Yeah. Oh, you know what? I have something that I can mention that grinds my gears right now, actually.
Go for it.
Downtown Riverside. I fucking hate the Festival of Lights. Holy shit. So the Festival of Lights. Okay, so basically for context, I live in Riverside. That is over by in the LA area. A lot of people know where I live. A lot of people know a lot of things about me. I literally don't hide any of it. I don't care about any of that stuff.
Can I have your address?
I live in the Yes, you do. So I live
No,
in
can I have it?
Like,
can you
Oh,
like,
no, you can't.
No, why not?
No, you'll probably just No, because you'll just send me dildos. I'm not giving you my address.
No. How dare you? First and foremost, I would send you pizzas. I would send dildos. You like 7 pizzas a day, which is like the worst gift, because it would go to waste.
Yep.
And that's
and
the
more... Like you have to eat it, but you can't eat it because it's just too many pizzas. And then you just get really angry because you can't eat them all. Oh my God.
Right. That's something about the holidays. Like any sort of situation where you're given gifts, you can either be like, okay, this is something I'm not going to use. I'm not going to feel bad about throwing it away. Like this is trash or doesn't work for me. Like it's not for me. I'm not going to use it. When someone actually gets you something that you can use and it's trashy and it breaks, or you just don't have space for it, that's when it's a problem.
Yep. Yeah, so, anyway, Festival of Lights. So, I live in Riverside. Riverside is near L.A., and when I say near L.A., it's like a two-hour drive away. It's not really near. But, I mean, by California standards, it's not that far. Anyway, I live in Riverside. And Riverside, every year, has something called the Festival of Lights. There is a really old hotel that is in downtown Riverside. And when I say downtown Riverside, it's not like LA or San Diego. The downtown Riverside is a small-ish, medium-sized metropolitan downtown. You got like maybe like 5 or 6 skyscrapers, and they're not even really that big of a skyscraper. They're like maybe like 10 to 15 stories tall, not big. And then you got like a bunch of like 5 to 10 story tall buildings, and then that's like it. It's a very, very small downtown, but it's got a couple of big buildings. Anyway, Festival of Lights. So what it is they create this big, gigantic festival in the center of downtown, where they block off and cordon a bunch of streets, and normally you can get through them, they're completely blocked off. And they're blocked off for literally a fucking month. So you have to find ways around these streets for a month. And the problem is I live very close to downtown Riverside. So if I want to go anywhere, I kind of have to go through downtown Riverside to get there. And the problem is if I make one wrong turn, I'm stuck in traffic for an hour. And that's stuck in traffic for an hour trying to move a quarter of a mile. An hour to move a quarter of a mile. That's how effing bad the traffic becomes in this area. And I cannot stand it. Because I keep forgetting that it's going on. Because it only happens... I mean, it's happening for an entire fucking month of a year. But still, it just kind of springs up on me. And I don't even think about it. And it's like, the light shows are beautiful. I like all these lights and everything. I just don't like the traffic. It pisses me off. And so that is my pee for the week. The Festival of Lights. It is a pain in the fucking ass. Love the fucking event. Hate the fucking traffic. And it's never ending for a month. That's about all I got this week. It's been a wonderful week for me.
So you hate this thing because it blocks traffic.
Yeah, that's it.
We have something similar to that here. It's called a farmer's market. And basically the street all by the waterfront, the street gets shut down because people have set up like shops and carts and whatnot.
Yeah.
Hey, can you ban that guy?
Yeah. Oh, yeah, sure. Do you need me to ban?
Basically every Wednesday they just, shut down the streets and set up shops and whatnot. So we don't have that street, which usually isn't a problem, except for the people that need to turn onto the bridge. So it's a little tricky. But other than that, it really doesn't, like, slow down traffic or anything. It's just, like, when you turn down the street, it's like, oh, it actually kind of ends, so you can't, like, turn around here. It really isn't that big of an issue, but for, a day, every single week, it shuts down a street. So it's a little bit more manageable, but it also happens more often.
Yeah, and my whole problem is that it shouldn't really affect. The house is right next to the on-ramp freeway, which is really close to off the ramp where this event is. And so, but since the streets around the event are.
Hold on just a second.
So not.
Hello?
Which means a large chunk of freeways.
Hello. Are you there? Delgar?
Maybe you can't hear me.
Oh, there you are.
Oh, you can hear me now?
Yeah, I can hear you now.
Okay, good. Yeah.
I don't know what happened.
Was that what
happened? You were talking about the City of Lights? Or the... Not the City of Lights.
Festival of Lights.
Festival of Lights. So what exactly is it?
Yeah.
Is it like fireworks?
Okay, so... No, it's literally they cover as much of downtown in Christmas lights as they can. They have a small little carnival that pops up in this one empty parking lot that's almost always empty, and they kind of have events there from time to time because it's always empty, and they put a carnival there. So there's like a Ferris wheel and a couple of games and everything. The whole streets get completely blocked off, so you can't walk in the street. You can't drive in the streets. You can only walk, and they block off an entire 2x2 city block. So very large chunk of city block and roads are completely blocked. And so you're just walking around. They have a parade near really close to when Christmas is. They only have the parade I think like once during the festival, but pretty much every weekend this festival is going on. There's lights everywhere. All of the shops are open all night long for the festival. So shops that are usually closing at like 7 or 8 o'clock because everyone's home and There's not really much of a nightlife. There's an actual big nightlife for once during this festival, because it's like all bright and everything, so people don't mind going out at night. So it's like it's a really nice kind of Christmassy vibe. And I love these kind of Christmassy vibes. Like, I am a sucker for the fucking city style Hallmark Christmas feel. I'm such a fucking sucker for that.
But you don't do it in the middle of the city.
No, you don't usually do it in the middle of the city. That's what drives me insane. Like,
we've
got
something
like
that.
Like a week.
But it's at the fairgrounds outside the city. Or actually,
yeah.
the Pepsi building outside the city limits used to have like these lights that they would hang up, and you could like go off the highway and then get in and then drive around the building and see like this display and whatnot, and it was really cool.
Yeah.
And sometimes cars were backed up turning off onto that, but very briefly. There was not people on the streets downtown going at two, like, I don't know.
I think it usually goes till about 11 or 12. And yeah, it's kind of funny because it's like it goes on for a whole fucking month. And honestly, it feels like what happened is I think they do it because this is a college town. Because even though Riverside is not a town,
they're trying to slow traffic.
I don't think it's necessarily that they're trying to slow traffic. I think there's so many people here, they want to drive up tourism. And this Festival of Lights brings a lot of people in for downtown and the outlying areas that normally just doesn't exist. Because it's very much a college town. Because we have UCR, the University of California Riverside, and it's a big UCR. I mean, it's a big university. So we've got a lot of fucking people here, and I think they just kind of want to make it like more quaint, I guess. I don't know what the fuck they're doing, but the point is that it brings a lot of traffic and tourism, and I mean, it's nice. I just wish it was a week long instead of a month long. I mean, you can't be doing some fucking Mardi Gras type of festival every night for a month. Just it's crazy, and yet it just keeps going. There's so many people down there every day, they just can't get enough of it. And all I can think of is why. I could not do that every couple of days for a whole month. I can go like maybe once a year, and that's good. I don't know, drives me crazy.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The problem with doing stuff for the holidays is that you can put up decorations and people can enjoy them, but when it becomes a significant issue and actual threat to public safety and influences how the traffic works, that is an issue that needs to be addressed.
Yeah.
It reminds me of this, there's this shop that has a bunch of windows, and so it puts, mm-hmm. like, a bunch of letters in the windows, and it spells out, let it snow, but it's uh-huh. broken up in a way that says, lay tits now, and I'm like, that has to be on purpose. That absolutely has to be on purpose. There's no way that you would do that with...
Okay. Okay, I'm sorry, but I very much support laying tits now.
Of course you would.
You've come to the wrong audience for this one.
Mm-hmm. No, I understand.
Yes.
The thing I was going to say, though, is there are people... that decide that November is when Christmas starts, even before Halloween
and
Thanksgiving.
Don't talk to those
people. We don't talk to those.
I can't stand those type of people. I can't stand those kind of people. My sister's one of them. Or not? Maybe not like before Thanksgiving, but my sister, she tried putting up the Christmas tree, like, literally as soon as we were done with Thanksgiving dinner. And all I can think of was, for fuck's sake, can you at least just, like, I don't know, maybe wait?
Let the turkey die. Until the food is settled
before you put the lights up? Let the food settle first, for fuck, crying out loud. Like, oh, man.
And there are people that get, like, really into it, too. They're, like, absolutely crazy. Just, like... immediately, like, it's Christmas. How do you not get this? We need to get started now. Oh, just cannot stand those people. And I appreciate the people that have the gusto to and are like excited about something and will have that can-do attitude to make it happen. But like, geez. Just calm down a little bit.
Just calm down a little bit. Crying out loud.
Yeah. I forget what I was gonna say. something else about those kinds of people. Oh, I remembered what I was gonna say.
Something let the turkey die.
There is only one thing that bothers me more than people that instantly decorate, and that's the people that try to get other people to care as much as they do about stuff. Like, I understand that Christmas is the time of like peace among men and cheer, and you know, it's the Christmas spirit, you have to be nice to everyone. You know, if any single person is like, you know, I just not really into Christmas, they're like, ah, you're Scrooge, you're evil, you're the devil reincarnated, how can you not like Christmas?
Some people like it, you some don't.
You are the reason why I don't like Christmas. Exactly.
Oh man, I know what you mean though about those the overzealous. It's like, I love Christmas. It's wonderful, but no need to be overzealous. I know what you mean.
I mean, I've said this before, but as soon as someone likes something too much and tries to force it on me, I lose interest. Yeah. Even if it's something that's really good, I just, you know.
Yep.
Oh, I'm instantly over it.
Yep.
Have you seen those big skeletons in people's yards?
Oh, yes.
Do you know how expensive those skeletons are?
Like $500 to $1,000. It's insane.
Usually like $1,500.
Yeah. They're so much. So much.
They're so annoying because people have them up. They've had them up for like months before Halloween. And people will continue to have them through the rest of the year. And here's why. Because there's no other place to put it. And even if there is, why would you spend $1,500 on something that you're only going to put up for a week, if not half of a month?
Yep.
So you just have to commit to this thing that you spent and invested so much money on, and it's just going to live in your yard now. And I get it. Like, it's cool. But, like, every single day I drive into town and I can see like five different giant skeletons, and they're like dressed up and like doing different things, and like, I get it, that's kind of cool, but like, can you not, like, why? The only reason why I kind of get the skeleton aesthetic is because imagine you bought a giant person, like a doll. You wouldn't be able to get away with it the same way you would with a skeleton, because as soon as you introduce a gender or a person, you have to make sure they're clothed. And if they're not clothed properly, then it becomes an issue. But with a skeleton, not only is it gender neutral, but there's also no bits, no bobs, you know.
True.
So in that sense, it is able to be humanized, but it also is still an object that you can't, you know, relate certain poses and actions to, for the most part.
Yep.
But goodness gracious, why do people... They're so expensive, too. I've seen parts of them go missing. And the reason why those parts don't get replaced is, I'm sure you can't just get parts, so you would have to buy a completely new skeleton. But, like, also, who's stealing parts of a skeleton to try and sell? Who's going to buy just, like, an arm of a skeleton? And I get that it's expensive, but goodness gracious, people.
I would imagine they're not stealing them for parts. I imagine they're stealing them for things that they want to do with it other than for a skeleton.
I mean, I can understand stealing the tires off a car because those can be expensive, but most people have a car. Who has a giant skeleton that they need to buy an arm for? It's probably the person that lost the arm of the skeleton that needs to buy an arm for a skeleton.
Yeah, could be. It's also possible maybe they just really want a large, gigantic skeleton arm. Like using it as, like, maybe, I don't know, maybe they got a cosplay where they need a large skeleton arm for whatever reason.
Not that big. Goodness. That's I don't know. Insane. I know what you mean though, but yeah. But just geez. Goodness gracious. That is too much.
I mean, maybe somebody has a cosplay where they are on stilts and they're as tall as a big mommy vampire, Demetrius, and they need a gigantic skeleton arm in their arms.
Or they just have, like, a big hand behind them. That'd be cool.
Yeah. Or maybe they just put a strap on the skeleton arm and they just strap the skeleton
arm. Oh, my goodness. What if you did, like, one of those Chinese dragons where you get a bunch of people under a tarp, but instead you make it look like a sock puppet?
Yeah, oh, that'd be pretty cool.
With a skeleton hand inside of it. That would actually be kind of funny.
That would.
Do you know anything about Naruto?
I mean, I know it exists.
There's this, like, special kind of ninja art called Susanoo, where you can summon you can turn your chakra into, like, a spirit form around you, and you can usually summon, like, a giant or whatever, but, like, the people that can't summon the full ones summon skeleton versions. So that's why you see Sasuke with, like, a purple skeleton arm or whatnot. Summoned basically a stand or whatever. So that could be something. And so maybe you get, like, a friend in, like, all black, and so they're just holding the skeleton arm, and you're just like, I summoned giant skeleton to punch you, you know?
Yep.
Yeah.
That'd you can also something. Just simply walk around with a big, gigantic skeleton arm and say that you found one of the pieces of skeleton.
You just walk up to I don't know. I was gonna make, like, a bone joke, and it wasn't gonna be good. And then I was gonna try for a handy joke, and that also wasn't gonna be good. So I've just given up.
Nope, just can't do it. Just failed.
Anywho, we're about half an hour in. Do you have anything you want to talk about, or should I go?
I mean, to be completely honest, this week has just been. It's been, like, stressful in the sense that it's been exhausting, but there hasn't really been anything that bothers me from this week. Because, I mean, as many people would know, this week was my birthday week, and I had the entire week off. And so I've been playing games and collaborating with people all fucking week long.
Nice. I didn't know that. I didn't know you had the whole week off.
I had the whole week off, and
I thought you were just trying to plan things for once.
Well, no, I actually had the whole week off for this.
And I didn't know that.
Here's the thing, though. Anytime I haven't been in a collab, I've either been hanging out with my sister, or I've been hanging out with other people, or I've been watching streams, or I've been meeting new people, and it's just there's been so much going on this week. I met a new streamer who I've become the best of fucking friends with just last week, and I hung out with them this week, and I
That's
hung out
cool.
with people who I haven't even hung out with in months this week, and I'm still trying to set up something with a German friend of mine for Sunday, and I'm going to the
That's something
aquarium
that's really
tomorrow,
important
and
too. Can I make a quick PSA?
yeah,
Like, there are
go for it.
friends out there that you are like the best of friends that you just haven't met yet. So like, don't just keep like struggling with like the people that you've lost or you really want to be closer with. Like, th there
Oh,
are other people out there that are like super cool and like bomb friends. You just
oh,
haven't
yeah.
met them yet. Anyways,
Yeah,
keep going.
I lost a lot of friends a couple years ago when I went through my big breakup. And honestly, like, I've met so many more people since then who've been just the most wonderful, beautiful people ever. And it's like,
I
yeah, you
met
just.
you at like the tipping point of that.
Oh, yeah.
I remember
You met me,
I was
everything came
friends with
crashing down.
someone on Overwatch and they invited me to the server, and that's sort of how I met Suki and like all those people.
Was that
And
Doctor?
what?
Was it Doctor that got you into the group?
I don't know.
I
There
thought it
was
was
like this
Doctor.
one gray
Yeah.
Katsune guy that was like he wanted to be my friend
Oh!
so bad. It was like his server and everything. And
Like
then
Katsune, or something like that.
I don't remember. I just
Yeah,
remember that like
I met
things
you
were
at that
falling
time.
apart and I was sort of in the middle of it. Like I'm a
That's
nobody. I
because
don't know
personally
anybody
got.
and I have no ties to anybody.
That's because that guy that got you into the group was the one that broke it all up. Because what happened was he was having a subathon, and he met me right at around the time that he was having a subathon. And I came and I gave him some support. And then I had a subathon just shortly, or a donathon just shortly after it. And apparently, he got really jealous of the fact that my donathon, with me having less people, was more successful than his. And yeah, and that was one of the biggest reasons why he literally just all hell broke loose, and he literally caused three different important friends of mine to ban me, and then other people to block me and stop being friends with me, and literally caused my entire friend group to just fall apart, all because he was angry that I had a more successful donathon than him. And the
That's
thing
so
was is that my
petty.
donathon was more successful because I didn't have a fucking job and I needed a bed. And someone bought me a bed. That's why he was jealous.
Because you were
Because I got a bed.
honest and more, you know,
Yes, basically,
vulnerable.
because I was honest and vulnerable, and I said, "Look, dudes, I'm sleeping on a couch. I'd really love it if somebody could help pay for this cot." And somebody literally outright bought the cot. And then they also bought a fold-out futon that I was going to use as the mattress for the cot, so that the cot was a lot more comfortable. And then they also got me a Steam Deck. Or not a Steam Deck, a stream deck. But it was like one of the really small ones. And it was still the nicest fucking gesture ever. I still really fucking appreciate it. And that was Lilith that actually bought all those things for me. I still very much am grateful for Lilith for doing that because I was in a really shitty situation.
Yeah.
Lilith helped me out a lot with that. But yeah, Katsu was literally just apparently, and this is what a lot of other people have told me, because he banned me, so I never heard it straight for him. But apparently, the reason why he banned me is because he was complaining to all of the people around him how my donathon was more successful. And I'm just like, dude, who the fuck cares? It's like, I know people who decide to do a donathon and it goes on for like 30 days, and they make tens, if not hundreds of thousands of dollars. I don't complain about them. It's like everyone has a different experience on this platform. If you're going to get really salty about somebody having an experience that was slightly better than you on this platform, then dude, you need to get the fuck off this platform because you're
I
going to be
mean,
angry
it
the
doesn't
entire
even
fucking
matter
time.
if it was better or worse, because you were technically in a worse
Yeah.
situation, so your situation wasn't
Oh,
better than
yeah.
his. Yeah.
It's like, oh my God, I made more
Everyone's
money than you,
different.
guy. I'm so sorry about that. Let me just wipe my tears with this fucking newspaper on the ground because I barely have a home and I have no bed. It's like, Fucking. And I, yeah, I just got out of the
You didn't have, like, money to spend. This was literally money to survive.
Yeah, I was literally in my sister's living room, sleeping on her couch, hoping to God that my fucking unemployment check would come in, and let me give you a newsflash, it never came in. Desperately trying to get a job because I had car payments that I had to make, and I couldn't just not make those car payments. And I was desperately trying to literally scrounge by and just make enough money to pay for the car. And I still had to make enough, and I didn't just have to make enough money to pay for the car. I also had to make enough money to pay for my phone, which was still under my ex's name. And she was kind enough to let me keep the phone as long as I made the payments every month. And I had to bend over backwards begging for her to do that.
Yeah.
Because she did not want to do that. She wanted to cut the phone off and force me to have to return it. And I begged her. It's like, I need a fucking phone so I can get a job. Please, I will keep paying you. I have never not paid your phone bill. If I miss a payment, then cut me off instantly. But as long as I can keep making it, please let me keep the phone. And she's like, as long as you don't fuck it up, I'll let you keep the phone. The first payment you miss, it's gone. And I'm grateful for her for doing that. Because if not for that, I never would have gotten the job I have now.
Yeah.
And yeah, so
I'm not going to pick sides here, but like everyone's experience is different and everyone has a different life.
Oh, yeah.
And you don't know what they're going through. You don't know what's going on.
Oh, and hell no.
This is the reason why you don't want to just instantly cut people out of your life, because you don't know what life they're having right now. And you don't know what that's going to do to them. They also don't know what they've done wrong, and they don't know what your life is right now and what's affected them and whatnot. So this is why it's important that when something happens that is important to you, that you actually, first of all, say something about it and don't just instantly surrender and give up and, you know,
don't bottle it up,
throw everything away. Yeah.
Yeah. Don't bottle it up. It's that simple. It's like, I don't understand why so many people are just so, I know exactly why. It's so easy to not care about people when you when they're online and you've never met them in real life, and you can easily just simply push a button to block them and you never have to hear from them again. And then 5 days later, you can become the best of friends, even better than you were with the other person, with some new person. And the internet has really taken away the lifespan of a friendship. And I feel that's terrible.
I don't necessarily agree with that, because I have had that happen to me in real life. It's easier.
You've never lost friends in real life.
I have absolutely, like, instantaneously within the same day had someone turn around and tell me that they hate me and completely cut me out of their life. Everyone, you know, in that friend circle treats me differently. People at school treat me differently. Like, that is something that can happen in real life. What I'm saying is that when it's over the internet, you can just completely shut out, but you can also do that in real life too, because you can just not go outside anymore. So I'm not saying that it's easier or difficult one way or the other, but it is different. Because you still need real people to do real things and choose to interact and talk and, you know.
Yeah. I just feel these days, because of the internet and the anonymity of it all, people are less willing to, I feel like the problem is people are more, how do I explain this? I think the best way to describe it is like with dating apps. When it comes to the internet, people are more willing to be very picky and choosy about who they're with and who they're friends with. Like, if you're not the perfect match, they can just dump you and look for another perfect match. And there's literally not just tens or hundreds or thousands or tens of thousands or hundreds of thousands or millions, but literally tens, hundreds of millions, and even billions of people out there that they can choose from. And there's always another person. But when you're in a town and there's only so many people in real life that you can meet, you're willing to become friends with somebody when there's a lot more caveats involved, and it's a lot less of a perfect situation. And I feel like the internet very much allows people to be picky and choosy to the point of unrealism. And a perfect example, I think, is so there was an actual news article that came out just a couple of weeks ago. So I watch a lot of different YouTubers. One of the YouTubers I watch, some people will say, yeah, they like this. And some people will say, I fucking hate this guy. But I watch him because my sister's husband watches him, and I like a lot of his streams. I watch Asmongold quite frequently. And he does a lot of different just random shit that he will react to and watch on stream. So I get to see a lot of different random things by watching him. He's one of many of YouTubers that I watch just the past time. But anyway,
like
there was
the
an article
guy
that,
you need, like, the reaction from. Apparently, like, his perspective on stuff is super important, and I don't know why.
And I think it has a lot to do with the fact that he lives like a fucking poor hobo, and yet he's a multimillionaire. And it kind of gives people that fact of he's actually somebody who can be wealthy and yet still have the kind of response that you would trust and believe in. Because the man literally does live like a fucking hobo.
He is an experienced gamer. He was there since like the beginning of World of Warcraft and RuneScape, and like, so he does have that perspective on things, and I think it's that humility that allows him to retain that sort of perspective on things that is good, that people enjoy and want.
Also, I do apologize if the car finally turned off. No, I've been sitting in the car dead, so now all of a sudden I'm based off of the phone.
So yeah, the one thing that I wanted to say, if you don't mind me cutting in real quick, is that
go for it.
The difference between social media and real life is not quickness or ease of access or tools and utilities, because at the end of the day, it's still up to that person to, in their mind, in their heart of hearts, to switch and, you know, turn off, I don't like this person anymore, I don't want to see them anymore, and then make the decisions to do that. And whether that be blocking them on the web, you know, whatever app you're using, you know, your phone, you know, turning, you know, blocking that contact, or like, you know, if you see them at school or at work, like changing classes or schedules or whatnot, there are things that you can do, and technology has allowed us to do it at a push of a button. But I don't think that's made it easier to do. It's just made it it's made it quicker to do.
Yeah. So here's the thing though that he reacted to. There was apparently a study that was done where, like a bunch of Gen Z were asked questions about who your ideal candidate would be, like what you're looking for in a date on online dating websites, and basically, apparently this one fucking thing was constantly popping up. And that was the fact that the vast majority, like some like 80 or 90, 80, I think it was like 80% of, or no, it wasn't 80%. It was just like the vast majority of the people they talked to thought that, in their opinion, no one would be dateable to them unless they passed a 6'6" and 6" rule. And that 6'6" and 6" rule meant that they had to at least be 6 foot tall, they had to be at least 6 foot long down there, and they had to be making a six-figure income. And these were Gen Zers that were in their 20s. And they basically were saying that they would never date anybody unless they fit those three criteria.
Now, and in their opinion, have a really ironic question. How many of them match that role?
Zero.
Exactly.
Because here's the thing. They literally thought that the reason why those criteria all had to match and they would never choose anybody unless they matched that criteria is because, in their honest opinion, they thought that there was close to, oh, what was it? I think they thought, so they thought that the amount of people in their age range that probably fit that criteria was somewhere around 40 to 50% of the male population in their age range.
Oh, so these are males? They're talking about males?
Yeah, these are women talking about males.
Okay.
These are women saying that they would never date anybody on a dating website unless they fit those three criteria.
Okay.
And they thought that there was a good 40 to 50% of all males in that, in their age range, which was 20 to 30, that fit that criteria.
Okay.
So let's think about this. They have to be at least 6 foot tall, which is not an average height. That is a very below average height. There are very few people that are over 6 feet tall compared to people who are not 6 feet tall. So yeah, that's the first thing that is not that common. Secondly,
I think I'm like six foot.
Yeah. Secondly, 6 inches is not the standard. It is not even close to the average. The American average is around 5 inches. So they also want people, they also think that the vast majority of men are well above average in that category. And then they seem to think that there's a lot of people in the dating pool in the age range of 20 to 30 that are making over $100,000. The amount of people in that age range that are making those three things all at once is less than 0.3% in that age range.
Yeah.
And yet the vast majority of women said that they would never date anybody unless they fit those three criteria.
Well, that's good then, because then those ladies will never date anybody.
No, that's not good, because that was a large portion of Gen Zers, which is probably why so many Gen Zers are single. Because they literally think that their perfect man is obtainable, and he's not. He has never been and never will be.
Well, the problem with kids these days is that while the rest of us have had this perfect idea of who we want to be and who we want to be with and what we want to happen, we've learned that that's not possible. While kids these days have not been told that. They have not been told no.
Well, yeah.
They have not been cut down to size.
Our parents told us no. Their parents don't tell them no.
Yeah, if their parents tell them no, they get canceled.
Yeah. And that's a problem. Our parents beat the fucking shit out of us with a fucking belt when we crossed the line. Their parents take away their Xbox for a day, maybe two. And then they just give it back to them a couple hours later.
And that's parental abuse if they do even
that. Yeah, and that's parental abuse. It's like this current generation is so fucking soft and stupid. It's sad. They're not prepared for the real world. And they're suffering for it. And because they're just so unprepared and unready.
See, here's the problem, is that if it was just them suffering, I wouldn't care as much. But they are actively trying to shape the world. And they are shaping the world.
I will say that there are, here's the problem though. A lot of people who are currently running the world are a bunch of old motherfuckers that need to just die off. So I can understand that side of things. I'm not angry with the current generation trying to shape them, because the current generation that's running it is doing worse, much, much worse. So I don't mind that side of it. What frustrates me so much is that this current generation is just so out of touch with reality, because no one tells them how reality really is. And the problem is they don't even listen anyway, because why should they listen? They have the internet, and the internet will tell them whatever they want.
Yeah,
and that's the problem. The internet is the problem. I hate to say it, but the internet really is the problem. We were last generation that grew up without it. Not really. We're the last generation that grew up without it. We hit high school as the internet was really starting to grow up. I mean, I remember being in school. I fucking hate dating myself like this. I remember being in school and having to plug in the fucking floppy disk to play Number Muncher or Oregon Trail.
I remember
because the computer could not run without a floppy.
I remember watching YouTube start from nothing and grow into something.
Oh, and I remember the llama song when it first came out.
I remember Badger and Mushroom.
Yeah. Like, I remember what was YouTube before YouTube existed. Newgrounds.
Oh my goodness. Newgrounds. Newgrounds was a little bit before me, but I respect and appreciate YouTube. It for what it was.
I remember Stick Death. Do you remember the website Stick Death?
No. But you've told me about it. I know what it is.
Yes. Oh my God. You can still find Stick Death too. You can find it on the Wayback Machine.
I was unfortunately a little bit behind the Stickman era.
Yeah.
I was more of a the invention of the meme with the rage faces and whatnot. That was that's where I was basically.
Yeah, that was all coming out of 4chan. Mm-hmm. There really wasn't an 4chan was pretty much where that came from. Yeah, because you had Newgrounds, and then from Newgrounds came Stick Death, and then 4chan kind of started to blow up.
Remember when Urban Dictionary was a naughty site?
Oh yeah, I mean it kind of still is. Yeah. Oh my God, man. Yeah, man. Oh, Zao Zao, Stick Death. Fuck, I remember all that shit. Newgrounds. Yeah, I remember the fucking random websites you would go to find little gifs of fucking Dragon Ball Z. Because there would be websites that were just all gifs. And you would save the gifs on your fucking little hard floppy drives. Oh my God, I'm so fucking
Yeah, we grew up with video games that were about a person doing something. And now, you know, people play video games where they can be exactly who the perfect person that they want to be and do the specific things that they want to do. And it looks exactly like reality. And anything less than that is unacceptable.
Yeah. Yep.
And the internet provides is the unfortunate thing, is that it actually provides. So the people that look for something specific and want that specific thing to exist, it does.
Yeah. If you want it, the internet has it. Yeah. If you want it, the internet has it.
I'm trying to think of how to segue into the thing I wanted to rant about.
Well, segue away, because it is already almost an hour.
Yeah, it's almost an hour. I've got like 8 minutes left. The really annoying thing that I wanted to talk about, which is something that I struggle with a lot, but I specifically struggle with it with my RPG games. Mm-hmm. First and foremost, one thing that I really struggle with is scheduling. You know, like, we do this one thing on the one day of the week at the exact same time, at the exact same place, and people will still get lost, still get confused, still ask what time it is, and forget to tell me that, oh, wait, I made plans 3 months ago, and I've known this entire time, but I've just never told you because I never thought it was important to tell you, and, oh, I'll just be gone, and the fact that I'm not there doesn't impact anyone else for any reason, even though I'm the only one that can drive the vehicle, and we're only here to meet this person because I want to specifically be there.
So, dude, I'm
your actions and inactions affect other people. Yeah. People.
Yep.
That is such a big one.
I didn't tell you that I couldn't join that D&D campaign that you want to do for no reason other than like no reason, like I didn't want to be in it. I would have been that person in that campaign the entire fucking time.
No,
I struggle not being that person in the current campaign I'm in.
I've tried to run one shots, but the reason why one shots are so difficult is because you have to introduce a brand new concept, world, plot, you know, thing that the characters need to be interested and motivated into doing, which is so hard and usually takes like 5 to 10 sessions to do before you actually get something rolling. Usually it doesn't take those 10 sessions. What does take those 10 sessions is for each of these new players to get to know each other and their characters to get to know each other and actually mesh and meld and start to understand how best to understand each other and work together. That takes a long time. And so this concept of people just want to being like, I just want to show up and play and leave, is such a selfish and horrible mindset. And the fact that they've gotten away with it for so long is, I have no words.
If you think about it, if you really, really think about it, when it comes to one-offs, that's kind of one of those things that's very common with one-offs, because with a one-off you do have people who just, they don't really know if they're really, if they really want to invest into something like this. And so one-offs, in my opinion, are like the worst for that, because of that very reason, because there's just a lot more there's just way more people who just aren't really sure if they want to stick with their, and so they're more likely to just kind of dip, because it's like, I thought I might have been into this, but I'm not really, so I'm going to dip.
This wasn't the thing that I was going to rant about, but I just wanted to mention it very briefly, because it's tangentially related to that. I mean, this is something that I just struggled with a little bit ago, because I had a session today where I had someone tell me last week, hey, I'm not going to be there. And I'm like, okay, cool. I figured out what to do with your character. You know, we'll just say that you're on the far end of the scene and we've got these other characters and they've got the thing happening.
Dude.
This morning, because I have to message people every single day, each person individually, hey, you, are you going to be here for the session? And I had two people say, oh, yeah, I'm not going to be here today. I just realized now that you've asked me.
Oh, my God.
Why do I have to keep track of you in your life and your decisions? So today's session was not very good, but I'm not going to get into that.
It sucks, man.
Afterwards, I've got a new player that wants to join. I get so many people that want to play. They so desperately want to play, and so they come to me and be like, hey, are you going to start a new campaign? Or, hey, can I fit into your campaign that's already gone through like a billion sessions, and now I want to introduce my new story and my new character in a campaign that's already full of characters and whatnot? And I'm like, that would not be a good idea. And so they say, hey, when are you going to do your new campaign? Hey, when are you going to do your campaign? And it's so infuriating, because you yourself, with this character that you have created with a story in mind of who they were and what they've done and the things that you currently want to do with this new item that you want to go get and this person that you want to see and these things that you have already done that is predetermined and designed that you want to shoehorn into my campaign, why don't you just make your own story since you've basically done all of the work already? Well, see, you don't understand, because as a dungeon master, you have to be... No, you don't. You know who runs the story and what happens? It's not the dungeon master. I'll give you 15 million hints and you'll still never get it. It's the players. The players run the show. They control everything. They decide what happens. The dungeon master decides what happens and can urge people and can push people in a direction and can motivate them and do all this stuff. But the players can still say no. The players can still do something that, you know, you can never make a player do something that they don't want to do. You can even try to make them care about something, and maybe they will, maybe they won't. And maybe you can try and understand what does make them work and what motivates them. And then the next session, they, you know, they're a different person. So there's just nothing that you can really do other than present the world as it is, curate their experience, and see what happens, and just roll with it.
Yeah.
And I get so many players coming to me like, hey, can I be this sentient magic object with this in this world, in this history? And I'm like, you know what? That sounds exactly like a dungeon master's explanation for a magic item for this thing. And they're like, no, you don't understand. You don't understand. And I'm like, oh, I think I understand perfectly. You just don't understand because you've never tried to do this. Being a dungeon master is not hard. It's just that people don't want responsibility. I don't like responsibility. I think I'm a very terrible leader, but I will rise to the challenge. I will take responsibility. I will make things happen. I will get things done. I became a forever DM because I so desperately tried to play so many different games to the point where there were no games to play. And so I said, you know what? Since there's no games to play, I'm going to make one. And then immediately got flooded with 20 people being like, you're running a game. Can I be this wizard druid, you know, dragonborn that summons dragons and turns into a dragon and can breathe dragons?
Mm-hmm.
And I've done so many different videos on my YouTube channel about this. And it's just so frustrating that I've had to come back to the same exact point of like, if you go into a campaign with a predetermined idea of who your character is and what you want them to do and where you want them to go and see, if you don't have any ability to like have character growth or change and whatnot, then you're not going to have a good time because A, you're not going to enjoy the campaign that the Dungeon Master has prepared for. You're not going to enjoy the other characters you're going to meet and the other players and what they're going to want to do. But you're also going to spoil the fun that the players want to have, and you're going to ruin the game that the Dungeon Master tries to present. And nobody's going to be happy. And whose fault is that?
Yeah.
But yeah, this player, and I don't want to say like that player, because this has happened multiple times, but basically like, so you tell me what options I have in the world. And I'm like, that's not how this works. You tell me the character you want to make, and I'll tell you how to make them. And like, no, I don't want to do that. I want to shop around for my options. And I hate that. I feel like that's a stupid way to do it. I understand that that's what people want to do. And I feel like that's what Dungeons & Dragons has forced people to do, is curate their experience so much that you only have these very limited options. Oh, also, here's a billion more options just so we have everything covered. Rather than being like, hey, what do you want to make? Here's the steps to make it happen.
Yeah.
Do people just want a multiple choice quiz with a billion options? Rather than just being like, here's a blank slate, write down what you want. I don't get it. Like, people create so creative and interesting and unique things, and yet try to shoehorn it into this tiny little box and make it work. And homebrew makes absolutely no sense, because you're trying to use a game system that you like for some reason, but doesn't do the things that you want it to. So you make up a whole new set of rules and systems that you're trying to use for it. But even that doesn't really work. So you're trying to tweak that a little bit and whatnot. And it's just like, why are you even still playing Dungeons & Dragons? You've completely created a new game system, and even that doesn't fit for what you're trying to do. There's this whole thing called creativity and theater of their mind and, you know, improv.
Yep.
You make a template, you get going, and you roll with it.
Yes.
Ah!
Yeah.
I want to yell and scream about this so much, and I could go on for another half an hour, I'm sure, but like, we gotta cap it off here, because talking about this is only getting me more frustrated and irritated, and it's not like this needs to be said, but venting doesn't help me. That's the problem. So me talking about this is only me like coming down on people with creativity. What I'm trying to say, you can do anything you want, so why are you trying to ask me what you can or cannot do, when what you should do is you know, do your actual homework, create your character, bring it to me, and I'll be like, hey, can we maybe change this a little bit? And they're like, no, it has to be this way. If you don't allow him to have his hair color red, then I'll just make a new character. And you tell me how you want him to be.
Yeah.
I'm like, just so you know, you can't be like the town guard because there is no like military presence in this area. You just live in a forest. And they're like, oh, well, then I'm going to be a talking log that rolls through the forest. And I'm like, so you want to be a tree? No, I want to be a log with no limbs that's sentient. So you want to be a magic item? No, I'm a soul possessed into this thing. So you're a lich? No, just like if you won't tell me what you want, why are you forcing me to present a billion different options and ideas just for you to say no to?
Yeah.
Like, in this position, nobody's happy because I can't present to you what you want and you won't tell me what you want.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. What would you do in my situation?
I don't know, man. I don't know. Because, see, what I often do, see, my whole problem is that I don't
like people.
I don't go, no. when I DM, I don't follow any of the actual rules.
Oh, me neither.
I just basically tell people, like, you do whatever, you be whatever the fuck you want. Like, if you want to be something, you tell me what you want to be, and I'll make it work. But if you can't provide it to me in a way where it can work, then no, you can't be that.
That's the best thing about being the one in charge. You decide how things work.
Yep.
Your character sheet is not for me to know what you can do. It's to help you organize your own stuff. It is not my job to know what you can or cannot do.
I mean, it depends. For some people, yes, it really is. For others, it's not.
There are people that are so controlling that they don't allow any creativity in their game. There are dungeon masters so afraid to give their players magic items that when they do, that one magic item will be, you know, just completely abused. And I'll tell you the reason why. It's because you are so afraid.
Mm-hmm.
I can't think of a single thing that a player can do to me that I would be afraid of, because here's why. You try to do something, I can either say no, and if they say, well, that's how this would work, I will say, here's why it's different, or here's why it doesn't work. Or even if it does, I can still make a dragon fly down and eat you, so shut up. Like, I don't understand these game masters that are so afraid of allowing creativity and options for their players when they themselves can make anything happen.
Yeah. I think it's because for some people it's very difficult to be creative. Like, they have a certain system and they want to stick with that system as much as they can, because once you start to veer from that system, become more creative, it's too much for them. It's too difficult.
It is difficult. It is definitely a problem, which is why lots of people like modules and whatnot with the pre-written adventures and whatnot. And so that's why it's scary when you move away from that, because then you don't know what to do. You don't know what the answer is. And I will admit that I'm not the most creative person, but I can react to things on the fly and just make something up and decide that, you know what, there was like a rat underneath that rug and now it's climbed up your leg and it grabbed the key and now it's gone off. And so people be like, why was it red? Why was there a rat underneath that rug? Wasn't that rug flat? Maybe it's a magic rat. Maybe it's somebody's familiar. And I'm like, you know what? That sounds like a great idea. And I'll be like, hey, if you make an arcana check, maybe you can see that it actually was kind of glowy and you would recognize it, that it was a familiar. but because it was red, you would know it was Inferno. And instantaneously, you know, I just made that up on the spot. We've instantly got some story, we've got some intrigue, and we've got some information. That's a familiar. It's going back to someone. He stole the key. It's for something. You know, it's a spellcaster. You've got instant information that you can just make up on the fly. That, you know, most people wouldn't know what to do. And it all starts with making a joke and a story like, hey, it's Pizza Rat. He's here to steal your pizza. You don't know what he's going to do. And then he goes back to the pizza parlor, and it's got like the big rat king. And he's like, hi, my name is Charles Chuck E. Cheese. And I'm going to, you know, steal your wife and your kids and make them play in my play place forever. And everyone's like, oh, shit, that's kind of a funny joke. But also, this is serious. And it's also something I can relate to. So I understand it a little bit better. But let's get going.
I mean, I can't relate to Chuck E. Cheese trying to steal my wife.
I meant kids. I don't know why I said wife. I think I'm thinking of the original.
I can't relate to that. I don't know.
The original meme.
Calling
like,
your wife, not mine.
He's climbing in your windows and snatching your people up.
Yep.
You know that.
Yep. Hide your kids. Hide your
wives. Hide your kids. Hide your wives. Oh my goodness. Yeah. It's That's so infuriating because these people are creative and they could run games and they sorry, this will be my final thing.
Yeah.
The hardest thing about starting is just starting, and because it's a new game system that people don't know, they feel like they need to know the rules. You don't. I still don't know all the rules. And if there is a rule that I need to know, I just look it up just to make sure. But here's the thing. I can make up new rules. I can invent new types of grappling and throwing objects. And, you know, if a penny falls from the top of the Eiffel Tower, should it kill somebody? Maybe in this world, yes, because copper is poisonous to people. But in the other world, no, because in the Underdark, the gravity is different or whatever. Also, you should never let... You should never let real life physics into the fantasy game because it will absolutely break it. I'll just give you that one for free.
Oh yeah.
And that's why you kind of need to throw the game system out the window from time to time, because it is broken, it is messed up, and you need to make what works for your situation. Tell a good story, have fun, make it work, but keep moving. Don't get bogged down with the specifics of who did what and what this word means in this context.
Yep.
Y'all are creative. Make stuff and keep going. Don't.
Oh my God.
Don't require other people to make your dreams come true. Make them come true yourself. You can run your own game with these stories. You've already written a story, just like all those 15 different characters that you made. Make it a town and throw the characters in it and see how they, you know, interact with them. It'll be fun.
Be dreams. Just do it.
Yeah.
Just do it!
I'm so much more heated at the end of this one than at the beginning.
Oh my God.
Which is usually how these podcasts go, because I am sort of like near the end, so I'm like, at the end of a rant, then I'm like,
which is
all right, now we're going to tie things up now.
Oh my God.
That's the thing, is that like I said, talking about stuff doesn't help me get it out of me. It just brings it back up.
Yep.
Which is why I don't talk about things. I'm a man. I hold things in forever.
Yep. Oh man.
I wish I could let things go. But I care too much, because I want to help. I want to fix things. I want to, you know, I can't just not care. I can't just not, you know, I can't just give up and let it go.
Gotta not care.
Yeah. That's the really unfortunate thing.
Yeah, it is unfortunate. That's just kind of how life is.
I will admit I do care too much. And that is a problem.
Yes.
Because I mess in other people's business. And that's not a good thing to do. You should never go into somebody's life and be like, hey, I can fix that for you. Even if it does need to be fixed, just one, don't be that person. And two, you should never fix something because your idea of correct is probably not going to be good for them.
No, it's okay. I can fix him.
Oh, goodness. No. Well, see, the idea with that is that she's going to burn herself out trying to repair someone that is not going to, you know, reciprocate.
You can never fix them.
That's how, I mean, that used to be the only problem with, like,
project. Not worth it.
Male and female couples was that, like, the guy didn't know what was going on, and she was, like, constantly pouring love and support into this. I've given him so much, and he never gives anything back. And it goes to the guy, and he's like, yeah, I thought it was pretty good. She was, like, doing a whole bunch of stuff for free. What do you mean, give stuff back? She never asked for anything.
Yes,
you should just know. Oh, I hate that so much. You should just, if you don't know, then I've got news for you. Okay, tell me. Oh, I can't even. What do you mean you can't even? I thought you said you had news for me. No, if you don't know, then you've got even more problems. Tell me what those problems are so I could fix them.
Yep.
Can't fix the problem if you don't.
We gotta stop the podcast. I'm literally raising my voice. I'm gonna flip my lid.
Yep. This is where we call it.
All right. Good night, everybody. Do you have any final words?
I find it hilarious how you always end up more heated and I always end up more relaxed.
Well, it's because you usually have something that you're like, man, this bugged me. Yeah. Yep. Maybe next podcast I should start, and you should finish.
Yeah, that works.
Okay.
Oh God. But yes. Anyway, you have a wonderful night.
All right.
And same for the rest of all of you.
Night, night.
Good boy, everyone.
Or whatever time of day you're listening to this.
Yes. Bye bye.